All right, today we come to Acts chapter 13, verse 31. Father, sanctify us by your truth. Your word is truth. In Jesus' name, amen. We begin our reading in verse 31. Actually, let's begin in verse 30, talking about how the religious leaders and the governor of Rome put Jesus to death. It says in verse 30, but God raised him from the dead, and he was seen many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses unto the people. And so Jesus continued to appear to his followers for 40 days after his resurrection. And every single one of them talked about it. How could you not talk about something that wonderful? Verse 32. And we declare unto you glad tidings with the promise which was made unto the fathers. Verse 33. God hath fulfilled the same unto us, their children, in that he hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second psalm, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Begotten means one of a kind or unique. Jesus has always been the eternal son of the eternal father. That certainly is unique and one of a kind. He has always existed as God's son. That certainly is one of a kind. However, Jesus was made known to the world as the Son of God by his incarnation, and that certainly is unique as well. 34. And concerning that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption, he said thus, I will give you the sure mercies of David. Verse 35. Wherefore he saith also in another psalm, Thou shalt not permit thine Holy One to see corruption. The resurrection of Jesus Christ was predicted in the Old Testament, and Paul quotes two of those scriptures right here. You know, theologians during Old Testament days couldn't figure out how the Messiah would die and pay for our sins, which the Bible teaches, and yet rule and reign forever in Jerusalem, which the Bible also teaches. How to reconcile those two things? They seem to contradict each other. But if they would have studied every single verse, and if they would have studied every verse and taken each verse at face value, they would have understood that, yes, the Messiah would die and pay for our sins, but that he would be raised physically from the dead, which would enable him to rule from Jerusalem. See, the Bible is clear. We just have to study it all, from Genesis through Revelation, and believe every word of it. 36. For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers and saw corruption. David served God in his generation. That's a pretty neat thing. You can't ask any more from anyone than that. And so let us strive to serve God in our generation, among our people. 37. But he whom God raised again saw no corruption. David's body has been dust for centuries. Jesus' body didn't get a chance to turn into dust because he wasn't in the grave long enough for any corruption to even begin. Verse 38, be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. So through Jesus Christ, there is forgiveness. Through him. All religions are not equal. Those that reject Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior fail to provide forgiveness for their followers, and that makes their religion useless. And yes, I said useless. Useless. Totally useless. A particular religion may have moral laws which promote good behavior, but it is worthless. It is useless. It is damnable if it doesn't provide forgiveness, because if our sins are not forgiven, then we're going to burn in hell and pay for them forever. Verse 39. And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which ye could not be justified by the law of Moses. Everyone who puts their trust in Jesus Christ, that is, everyone who receives Jesus as Lord and Savior, is free from guilt and is forgiven by God. And that's something which the law of God, as holy as it is powerless to do. You can't possibly hope to get into heaven by following the law of God, because you can't follow it good enough to be saved. No one can. Verse 40. Beware, therefore, lest that come upon you which is spoken of in the prophets. In other words, be careful. Or the bad things that the prophets predicted would happen to those who would rebel against Christ will surely happen to you. You know, God doesn't just warn. He doesn't just warn. He doesn't warn just to show that he predicts the future, but to give us an opportunity to repent before judgment day hits. You say, when judgment day hit, the moment you die, it's sealed. Verse 41, behold, ye despisers, and wonder, and perish. For I work a work in your days, a work in which ye shall in no wise believe, though a man declare it unto you. And this is what the prophets predicted would happen for rejecting Christ. It would bring earthly and eternal suffering. Too bad the Israelites didn't listen to the prophets, because over 1 million of them were killed by Rome in 70 AD precisely for rejecting Jesus Christ. And those who persisted in spiritual rebellion, like Gentiles who persist in spiritual rebellion, die and go to hell. 42. And when the Jews had gone out of the synagogue, the Gentiles besought that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. So the Gentiles who heard Paul preach couldn't wait for the next Bible study. You know, it's very easy to tell the difference between a little sermonette and Holy Spirit anointed preaching. Anointed preaching and teaching makes one crave for more of the Word of God if they are right with Christ. 43. Now when the congregation had broken up, many of the Jews and religious proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. They were so excited about the Word of God in Jesus that they followed Paul and Barnabas down the street after the service. And notice that the one thing they urged the people to do more than anything else was to continue in the grace of God. In other words, keep accepting the mercy of God which he offers through Jesus Christ. In other words, never stop confessing, never stop repenting, never stop accepting the mercy of God. That's the worst thing that anyone could ever do. And that's, God doesn't want you to abandon his grace. 44. No matter how many times you have to use it. And the next Sabbath day came almost the whole city together to hear the word of God. So the people who heard the word of God the previous week told others how great it was. And that's why the place was jammed the following week. Get hungry for the Word of God. Because if you are, then your excitement for Scripture will be contagious. Be on fire for Jesus, and others will catch fire for him as well. 45. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and spoke against those things which were spoken by Paul, contradicting and blaspheming. There's the opposition that always comes when one proclaims the word. The word of God separates like a sharp sword. It draws those who love truth and have a heart for God. Meanwhile, it irritates those who despise God and have no desire to repent. 46. Then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, "It was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you. But seeing ye put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles." If you reject Jesus Christ, then you condemn yourself. God doesn't condemn those who won't repent. They sentence themselves to hell. John 3:18 says, "He who does not believe in Christ is condemned already." 47, "For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light of the Gentiles, that thou shouldest bring salvation unto the ends of the earth." You know, there comes a time when Christians must give up on those who reject truth and give it to others who may be open. That's why they turned away from the Jews and went to the Gentiles. You can only put up with rejection for so long before you realize, hey, wait a minute, I'm spinning my wheels here. 48. "And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord. And as many as were ordained to eternal life believed." Christians can't take credit for their salvation or even wanting it. As many as were ordained to eternal life believed. It's true that we can either receive or reject Jesus, but God is always the one who makes the first move when one receives him. Our faith is a gift from God. 49. "And the word of the Lord was spread abroad throughout all the region. But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable women and the chief men of the city, and raised a persecution against Paul and Barnabas, and expelled them out of their borders. But they shook off the dust of their feet against them, and came unto Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit." And shaking the dust from their feet, as you may have guessed, was a symbolic act. It meant, I've done my part. So when God judges you, your blood will be on your own hands, not mine. When judgment day comes and Jesus sentences you to hell, you will have no one to blame but yourself. I did my job. I gave you the truth. And once we give someone the word of God, we can pray for them, but they choose what they're going to do with it. And they are responsible for the choice that they make.